Hope. Great to see you guys here today. If you are watching online from home or vacation, welcome as well. We're glad you're here to worship with us. Man, what an opportunity we have today to sing and to praise God, to give Him our best, and to just hear from Him and His Word today. So I welcome you for the next hour, just to give your heart to Him as we worship. I invite you, stand, let's sing together, let's worship together, and let's enjoy our time together as the church body and worshiping our God. Here we go. I was walking the wayside, lost on a lonely road. I was chasing the highlight, trying to satisfy my soul. All the lies I believed in left me crying like the rain. I saw lightning from heaven, and I never. I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it, I am a child of love. I found the world of freedom, I found the friend of Jesus, I am a child of love, yeah. I felt the steam. Start. Hey, listen, I want to invite you just for a second, if you would have a seat, just for a second, please. Do something a little different this morning. I I got an email from somebody a couple days ago, and they were just lamenting and maybe struggling is the right word. Over just a lot of things happening in our world right now, talking about what we see happening over in Afghanistan with our military and the civilians, what we see a massive hurricane heading for the Gulf Coast this morning and the people in that path, what's going on with COVID and just that resurgence and the things that that bring in, plus anything that might be going on in your personal life. And we're getting ready to sing a song called Come Out of That Grave, which is about the resurrection power of Jesus. And what the song is talking about is us singing and calling on and praying about the power of God to come into our lives and to be a part of our world around us. And I don't know how he's going to choose to answer our prayers about any of these things. But I know when we call on him, we are calling on the same power that rose him from the dead. And that power can do anything. And if nothing else, we want that power to show itself, to make his name known. So I'm going to call on you right now before we sing the song. If you will, just join me in a time of prayer over these things. Will you do that with me, please? Father, we come before you this morning, and there's a lot to be concerned about. There's a lot of distraction, a lot of fear. And we see things happening in the news that maybe it stirs us up and makes us angry. We see things happening in the weather and nature that are putting people's lives in danger right this moment. We see this virus that's been with us now for a year and a half, and so many of us are just tired of it. But we recognize how dangerous it really is and how divisive it's been in our society over vaccines and masks and all these things. And God, we just lay these things at your feet. I ask that as a church that we can come together unified in worship, to call on the resurrection power of your spirit, to make your presence known, to bring healing where it's needed, to bring peace where it's needed. And God, that you will stir our hearts this morning as we continue singing and worshiping, to know that you are here with us and that we belong to you and that we can trust that above all else. God, please let that inhabit our praise this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you wouldn't mind, let's stand together again. Let's sing this song. Let's call on the resurrection power of Jesus. There's a sling in my voice and a stone in my praise, pushing back when the darkest weapons form. And there's a power on my lips, even death can't defy, when the name of our God is lifted high. Cause there is resurrection power when we sing the name of Jesus. Resurrection power when we praise the mighty sound. So come on, let the praise us get loud.
There are days I have seen filled with heartache and loss, and I dare not.
awesome to claim that with you guys as a church this morning. If you would have a seat, please, as Jamie McCormick makes her way up and is going to share some thoughts with us to prepare our hearts and minds for a time of communion together today.
Matthew 26, verses 27 and 28. Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Before Jesus died, God's people sacrificed lamb each year during the feast of Passover to remind them that God brought them out of slavery in Egypt. Jesus perfectly timed his death to take place at the beginning of Passover when God's people were sacrificing their own lambs. This would demonstrate that Jesus' death is the once-for-all sacrifice of God to save his people from their slavery to sin, in other words, to save us. We remember Jesus' sacrifice by celebrating the Lord's Supper, instituted by Jesus the night before he died. We call this communion. It is a celebration, but it's also to be our confession that we need to be forgiven. Every time we take the bread and the cup, we remember together that we're sinners who needed Jesus to die for us. We needed his sacrifice. And in the Lord's Supper, our guilt is met by the saving grace of God. And as we eat and drink today, we are assured that God's grace overcomes our guilt because of the sacrifice of Jesus. Communion is a reverent practice, and we, as this beautiful mosaic body of believers, together we become bound in our faith. We're built on the bond that Christ's blood was shed as the perfect sacrifice once and for all, so that the chasm between our sinful, imperfect nature would forever be filled by the outstretched arms of Jesus Christ. He died for me. He died for you before we were even born, so that when we would come to know Jesus and accept him as the Son of God, accept him as our living Savior, we would be saved and justified before our Father. So as we approach the table, reflect on the life that we've been given, the opportunity Christ gave us to live eternally in heaven. How much we're loved, even if it's only by remembering the anguish that Jesus willingly suffered to gain our freedom. Would you pray with me? Jesus, I'm so sorry for my sins. I can't even begin to adequately thank you for taking my place on the cross so that I could be forgiven. Your love is absolutely unquestionable. You are my living hope. I ask you to come fill this body of believers with your presence, Lord. Amen.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Now
Corinthians 11, verses 23 through 24. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me," the body of Christ. In verse 25, in the same way, he took the cup, also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
We are all looking for something more out of life. Something that gives us purpose. Direction. A sense of community. For the past 2,000 years, people have found these things in a place called church. For centuries, the church has helped those who couldn't help themselves. The hungry. The lost. The outcast. It's been a place of healing and restoration for those who've been hurt. A home to orphans. A comfort to widows. And a refuge to the sick. But the church does so much more than just reaching out to those in need. It's a place where together we can grow, laugh and play, worship and learn about a God who loves us unconditionally, and see firsthand how his love impacts the world around us. Because of Christ, we all share a common bond. And it's through the church that we can really live life together. Welcome to church.
I heard a story about a little girl named Sarah, who, this was years and years ago, but Sarah, she lived with her family out on their farm, and she had a dream. She had a dream she wanted so badly to see the circus. She had dreamt her whole life. And just she wanted so badly to see the circus animals, the elephants and the bears and the giraffes. She wanted to see the clowns. She wanted to see the acrobats. She wanted to see everything, and she dreamt about it. But she knew deep down in her heart it was never going to happen. She might as well have been on the moon as Shelby Town, Arkansas. I mean, she lived 45 miles outside of Little Rock, and back then the roads were terrible, washed out by storms. She knew there was no way. The family didn't even have a family car. Just an old Ford pickup's all they had, and there was just no way that she was ever going to make it out to see the circus. And she would be talking about it and dreaming about it, and her dad would, you know, just kind of say under his breath in the morning, "Well, if you want to see some animals, you can go out and milk the cows," you know. And that was about as far as she ever got with it. She knew it was a dream that was never going to come true.
I mean, she had heard about the circus coming through. Well, sure enough, word went around one day that the circus was coming to Little Rock. And she kind of had this glimmer of hope that maybe, no, her parents kind of blew it off. And she went on until one day the mailman shows up and has a registered envelope, cardboard envelope, and shows up and delivers it into her hands. It had her name on it and printed on top and big giant letters was the Templeton Traveling Circus seen on 5 continents. And she just started to tremble. She ripped the envelope open and out came 3 full-color cardboard tickets to the circus. And her dad and mom were standing there smiling at her. Said, well, it's been a good year and you've done great with your grades. We thought this would be a wonderful treat. Oh, man, she couldn't wait. 9 days until the circus, and she was going to get to go. She was going to be there. She dreamt about it at night, and she couldn't hardly sleep. But she knew she was going to get to go, and finally the day comes. Her mom and dad and her, they pile into that old farm truck, and they start making their way to Little Rock. It was a rough drive, bouncing all over the place. But finally, after a couple hours of driving, they find themselves coming up on the campground where the circus is going to be. And as they pull up, they see the giant tent being set up. And off to the side, along the railroad tracks, they see the train that the circus had come in on, pulled off on the siding rails. And they could see the colorful animals and pictures drawn on the side of the train cars. And that's when she noticed, right as they parked and got out, she noticed that they were all the performers, all the animals were kind of loading up. You couldn't really see them, but they were all lining up on the other side. And she heard the buzz in the crowd as people started to gather. There's going to be a parade. And so she couldn't wait, and her daddy put her up on his shoulders, and they're watching. And sure enough, before too long, the parade begins, and the animals come by. She got to see the big giant elephants and the bears and the giraffes, and all these animals are coming by, and she's just giddy, giggling. She's so excited. And then come the acrobats and the clowns acting all goofy. It was the most exciting, by far the most exciting moment of her life. She could not imagine being any more excited than she was in that moment. And after about 30 minutes, all the performers pass by and the parade ends. And she lets her dad put her back down on the ground, and she turns to her parents just beaming and says, oh, thank you so much. Thank you for so much for bringing me to the circus. I guess we got to go home now. And her mom stopped and said, no, you're missing it. That was just the parade. The circus is tonight. And she, her eyes just lit up. She couldn't believe it. It was going to get even better. But when I hear that story and I think about us, and I think so often about the lives we lived, we spend so much time getting excited about all kinds of things in our lives. And God's saying, but I've got something so much better if you'd give me a chance to show it to you. We're willing to settle so often for the parade that we forget that there's something even bigger on the other side, you know? I wonder if you can think of anything right now in your life that you have put so much value in. Have you ever done this before? You put so much value into something that you missed what was better on the other side. Have you ever experienced that before? I've done it. I'll try to think of a few examples. And I think we all do it. I do it every time I go to the Mexican restaurant. They put those chips on the table, right? And I just sit there and I fill up on the chips and the queso or whatever. And then by the time the meal gets there, what? I can't even enjoy it, right? The meal would have been so much better, but I couldn't help myself. I do that. It's well documented. I'm kind of a weather nerd. And so I get so excited about things like snowstorms and thunderstorms. And I'll be watching the app. And I'll be watching an app like when a big thunderstorm's coming, and I realize I missed the thunderstorm because I was watching the app. Just went right on by. You know, I do this all the time. I remember when my kids were little. You know, and some of you have experienced this before when your kids are small. And you get all their presents and everything, and they get up on Christmas morning, and everything's set out. But what is it they want to play with? The boxes, exactly right. I mean, I was like, well, if I'd known, I could have just gone and picked up a few empty boxes at Walmart. Happy Merry Christmas, everybody. You know, and it's so often that we get so excited about the things that were never really intended to be the valuable things. You know, on a more serious note, I find myself sometimes putting so much value in winning the argument that I forget about the relationship that might be getting damaged on the other side. Sometimes, you know, I get so caught up in the winning, I miss it. I do it here at church. On Sunday morning or Thursday night when I'm getting ready for the service, I spend so much time trying to get all the details covered and making sure everything's perfect that I forget or I miss the opportunity to connect with people. It happens, right? Can you think of some times in your life when you've done this? You've put value into something and you miss something so much better on the other side. That's what I want to talk a little bit about today as we finish up this series. Because I want to talk about something of great value that I think a lot of Jesus followers are missing. And I think it's the value of what it means to belong to the church. We've been talking for the last few weeks about me, myself, and others. And what I mean, how God created us to not experience this life alone. We were created to experience the journey of life and our journey of faith with others. And He gave us the church, the body of Christ, for a reason. And today I want to talk a little bit about that because I think many people in our world today will say that they can be Christians and followers of Jesus outside the church. But my question is, why would you want to? And it's not my place or my desire to question somebody's salvation because they choose to reject the church. But when I look at the church, I see something special. I see a gift that Jesus gave us so that we wouldn't have to experience everything that comes along in our life and in our journey of following Jesus. So we don't have to do that alone. Is the church flawed? Absolutely. But I believe something can be both flawed and special at the same time. Today I want to put this truth in front of you to think about. The church is both deeply flawed and exceedingly special. And we may say how. And I've been saying, and I want you to make sure, you might say, okay, you're preaching a sermon to a bunch of people sitting in church. Hello, is that a waste of time? Here's the thing. Because there's a difference, we've talked about this, there's a difference between going to church and belonging to church. There just is. And so today the challenge is for all of us to look and say, am I really engaging? Do I really belong to the church? Does the church belong to me? Or am I just kind of here attending, checking off the box, letting it pass by week in and week out? Am I really here belonging? Being a part of what the church body was meant to be? Or am I missing that opportunity? Am I missing the opportunity to be a part of something special? And that's why we need to talk about this today, because I need you, I'm calling on you, I'm challenging you to examine your own heart with this one. I think it's that important. You see, I think there are a lot of people who have chosen, it might be some of us in here, and it might be a lot of people who won't step inside a church building, but a lot of people have chosen to reject the church or even to go as far as demonize the church because of its history. You know, just a few examples. I mean, people will point to, if you're someone who really has looked into church history and understands historically some things that have happened with the church, you look back to the 3rd century. The first 3 centuries of the church were much like what we see in the book of Acts, but something happened in the 3rd century. Constantine made it the state religion, Christianity, the state religion of the Roman Empire. And at that point, he began bringing in pagan elements into worship, and some of which we still practice today. A lot of us, we're not even aware of some of the elements that we practice in our worship today that were pagan elements brought in by Constantine in the 3rd century. There will be people that look at that and say, look at the church, how can that be a good thing? It's flawed. I don't want to be a part of that. We'll go a little further. We know Martin Luther and the Protestant Reformation led to the church splitting. And since then, the church has continued splitting over and over again, denominations all over the place. Why we have churches on every street corner. And people will look at it and say, you can't get along with each other. Why would I want to be a part of that? The church is flawed. And that's people's excuse. Think about the Crusades and the horrible things that happened in the name of church, in the name of God, murder, stealing, abusing power. All that's happened historically. They were very dark times, awful times in the name of the church. The church is flawed. There's no question about it. And we keep asking, is it? How can I stand up here and say that it's something special with all that being true? But even history aside, guys, I know there are a lot of people in today's world who've been hurt by the church personally, or they've seen the flaws firsthand and have some pretty major issues with it. And I got to tell you, every time I'm watching the news and I hear about a sexual abuse scandal that is connected to the church somehow, man, it breaks my heart and it makes me angry. Is the church flawed? Yeah, it is. And when I hear about people inside the church who are saying hurtful and hateful and judgmental things against people they disagree with and standing on the name of Jesus to call them those names and to treat them that way, not realizing that you might be costing the only opportunity we're ever going to have to reach those people by saying those things. I personally know people in my own life who've experienced some really damaging behavior at the hands of a pastor or other church leaders. And I don't know if they will ever be willing or able to be a part of a church because of that. I know people who are disillusioned with church because they've just too many times seen flawed leadership, seen scandals with money, affairs, things like that. Man, that's a lot, isn't it? I'm not trying to drag us down here and to beat us up. That's not really the point of this. But because the church is made up of flawed people, for now, the church is a flawed body. And with that being true, you have to ask the question, well, what's so special about it? With all of the history, with all of the scandal, with all the abuse and neglect and mismanagement and examples of poor leadership, why would I stand up here today and tell you that the church is exceedingly special? Why would we want to belong to something so flawed? And so that really is the hook question today. The question I want you to think about, and I just want you to ask yourself, is belonging to the church truly worth it? Is belonging to the church really worth it? I'm not asking you to check the box of church attendance every Sunday. Is belonging to the body of Christ really worth it? Today we have to try to answer that question. What's so special about the church that makes it worth being a part in spite of all of its flaws? To me, when I started thinking about that, I went to Acts chapter 5. And I don't know why. I wasn't really sure what text I was going to land on this week until I hit Acts chapter 5. And you guys know I talk about Acts all the time. I love the book of Acts. And so we see here the first couple of chapters are Jesus has ascended back up into heaven and has left his disciples to wait on the Holy Spirit to come and guide them. And at Pentecost, that happens. The Holy Spirit comes. Peter stands up, preaches the first gospel message. 3,000 people come to be saved that day. And the church is off and running. And we see them meeting all over Jerusalem, and people, they're adding to their number daily, those are being saved. And then we jump ahead to Acts chapter 3, where we see Peter and John going to the temple to pray, and they heal the guy at the gate, and it stirs everybody up, and the Sanhedrin, the high priest, are telling them, you got to quit it. You see, they killed Jesus for a reason. The Jewish leadership, the Sanhedrin is the Jewish leadership, made up of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They were like the elders for the Jews. And they killed Jesus on a cross because they wanted to stop this movement. They didn't want his name being preached. And they warned Peter and John they better cut it out, but they didn't listen. What other name are we going to speak in besides the name of Jesus? And they kept going. And that's where we jump to chapter 5. And that's what I want to read you today, starting in verse 12. Is take a look at what's happening with the church in Jerusalem at this time. It says, the apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people. And all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared to join them, even though they were highly regarded by the people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. As a result, people brought the sick into the streets. I love this part. Look at this. Look at what's happening. This is how the people felt and how they saw the Christians, the church. It says, as a result, people brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and mats so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by impure spirits, and all of them were healed. Try to picture that scene in your mind. What's happening in Jerusalem as they're healing, as people are coming. And you got to imagine, the Sanhedrin, the Jewish council, sees all this happening in the name of Jesus. They're not happy about it. So what happens in the next few verses is they go to arrest these guys. They arrest the apostles and they throw them in jail because they're preaching and spreading this name of Jesus and teaching this new way that was a direct threat to the Jewish power of the day. Well, that night, it tells us that an angel of the Lord appeared to the apostles, that opened the jail cell doors, and they walked out, and the angel gave them an instruction and said, you are to go back to the temple courts, and you're to teach the people out in front of everybody. And so they did as they were told. It says the next morning, it was about sunrise, the next morning they go out to the temple courts, and they begin, the Christians, the apostles, they begin teaching and healing again in the name of Jesus. Meanwhile, back on the ranch, the Sanhedrin, they wake up the next morning and they get ready to meet again. What are we going to do about these guys? And they say, go get them out of jail. They have no idea that they're not there anymore. Go get them out of jail and bring them here. So some guards go down to the jail. There are guards standing guard outside the jail cells. They turn around and they say, we need to bring the guys to the Sanhedrin. They turn around, they open the doors. The cells are empty. Where'd they go? They were in trouble. So they go back to the Sanhedrin and said they're not there. Well, somebody else comes in immediately and starts reporting. They're all at the temple court and they're all teaching again. They're healing again in the name of Jesus. So the Sanhedrin says, go get them and bring them here. Now, they sent some guards to go get these guys and bring them back before the Sanhedrin. The guards wouldn't use force because they were scared of the crowd, but they did bring them back. So here stand the apostles back in front of the Sanhedrin, having already been thrown in jail and miraculously released. Let's see what happens next. Starting in verse 27, the apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name, he said. Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. Talking about Jesus. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, resurrection power, right? Whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as prince and savior that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit whom God has given to those who obey him. And you can imagine that didn't go over real well. Look at the next verse. When they heard this, the Sanhedrin, they were furious and wanted to put them to death. But I love this part. But a Pharisee, one of their own, one of the Sanhedrin, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law who was honored by all the people, stood up in the Sanhedrin and ordered that the men be put outside for a little while, the apostles. When he addressed the Sanhedrin, then he did that. He said, men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do to these men. Some time ago, Theudas appeared, claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men rallied to him. He was killed, and all of his followers were dispersed, and it came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean appeared in the days of the census and led a band of people in revolt. He too was killed, and all of his followers were scattered. Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone. Let them go. For if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God. It says his speech persuaded them, They called in the apostles, and they had them flogged. They were, and flogging isn't a light thing. They were beaten severely. They called the apostles in and had them flogged, and then ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus. And they let them go. And the apostles left the Sanhedrin. Look at what they did. They'd just been beaten severely. They left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day, in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is Messiah. Man, that's a cool story. I love to try to picture what that was like. But it brings me back to the question, is being part of the church worth it? With all of its flaws, with all the history, with all the personal experience you may have, is being a part of the church worth it? And I want to answer that with three questions today. I think if we can answer these three questions, then you can come back to a conclusion for yourself. Is being a part of the church worth it? Here's the first question. What is its purpose? What's the purpose of the church? Why does the church exist? Why is it here? Let's start there. Well, there's several things. You can't answer that question with one word. Like, for instance, the church is about fellowship, right? We're here to encourage each other, to build each other up and support each other and love each other in good times and bad, to hold each other accountable when we get off track. But there's more to it than that, isn't there? We're here, the church is about community. We're here to meet people's needs. We are here to go to the pain in our community. We just are. Whenever and wherever there is pain in our community, the church, we should be there trying to help, trying to make a difference, all in the name of Jesus. But it's more than that. The church is about discipleship, helping each other grow to be more like Jesus. Back before COVID hit, we had introduced a discipleship kind of a visual that we wanted to take everybody on called Life Tracks. And we want to kind of put that back out. Now that we're trying to kind of get things going again in the right direction, we want to reintroduce this concept to you of what Life Tracks is, about discipleship here at New Hope. You know, there are all kinds of ways we can accomplish it. And we've talked about saying we want to give everybody at New Hope five tracks that they can get on that deal with different aspects of their spiritual journey. You don't have to do all of them at once. And honestly, you never really complete any of them. It's just five different ways that we want to help you grow to be more like Jesus. And the challenge is we want everybody to engage each of these five and add to them as they grow. We start with Discover Track, the classes, what some people still call Sunday school, our Sunday morning 9 o'clock classes. It's sharing information. It's someone teaching. It's Bible study. Discover Track's important. I would challenge everybody to get engaged in that somehow, some of the electives that we offer. We have what we call Connect Track, being a part of a Connect group. And that goes deeper. It's not just about Bible study. That's about building relationships in a small group setting, getting to know each other, sharing a little bit of life together. That's a big deal. That's an important aspect of our growth. This one we're going to be talking about in the month of September is Ministry Track. Ministry Track is our desire to get involved in ministry and serving people and making a difference and reaching and spreading and sharing the gospel with others in some different way. Over the next month, we're going to put in front of you 17 different ministry opportunities, ways that you can plug in to making a difference in people's lives. Some of those will point inside the church. Some of them point to reaching out in our community, but they're all equally important. And the challenge is going to be pick one that you can be passionate about, that you can get involved in and say, I want to make a difference somehow with using my gifts, my talents, my interests, my passion. That's Ministry Track. We've got two tracks that we're going to be starting up here in the near future. One's called Rooted Track that's going to be focused on helping people develop the spiritual disciplines in their life. And we'll talk more about that later. And then the fifth track is Core Track, which is where we're going to challenge you to get with three or four other people, same gender as you. Not where you're meeting, not where you're having Bible studies together. It's just a connection point, where you can text each other or get together for breakfast every now and then and just say, how are you doing? How's your marriage? How are things going at work? How are things with the kids? Being able to help each other. 5 different tracts that address different and very important aspects of your spiritual journey. But you're going to hear us, and I wanted to put that in front of you this morning, that we gave out these keychains that say life tracts, and we have a disc that we give everybody when they engage one of these different tracts. It's just a reminder that I'm engaging my spiritual journey and discipleship in a different way and adding to that as I go. So you're going to hear us talk more about that, but I wanted to put that back in front of you this morning. But that's what the church does, is we help each other in discipleship. But not only that, the church is about building God's kingdom here on earth. Yes, we are flawed for now, but one day Jesus is coming back for his church, and the flaws that are here now are going to be gone. And guys, I want to be a part of his body on that day. And I got to tell you, thinking about all those things that the church does, that makes the church pretty special to me, in spite of all of its flaws. I got to be honest with you, to me, it's totally worth it. The second question I want to ask today is this. If we're talking about, is the church, being a part of the church, belonging to the church, is it worth it? I want to ask, what is its origin? I love that part in chapter 5 of Acts, where the Pharisee, Gamaliel, he stands up. And remember when he said this? He said, if this is of human origin, it's going to fail. But if this is of God, then we can't stop it. We just find ourselves fighting against God. What's the church's origin? I look back at Matthew chapter 16. Jesus' conversation he had with Peter. Go ahead and show that scripture. Verses 18 and 19, it says, and I tell you, Jesus said these words to him, that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. We see in Acts chapter 1 and 2, Jesus has ascended back to heaven, and they're waiting on the Holy Spirit, and when he comes, it launches the church. What's its origin? Where did it come from? I got to tell you, yes, the church has gotten off track many times throughout history. And some would say that the American church is badly off track today, and I would not disagree with them. But let me say this. The church is not an invention of man. It is from God. It is his church. We aren't perfect, but we can certainly get back on track with what the church is supposed to be. We might get easily distracted, but guys, I'm telling you, New Hope, I'm telling you, we can come together right now and we can focus on what he's called us to be. His church, sharing his love, building his kingdom. And guys, for me, it's totally worth it. That is something I want to do. The third question, I think it's going to be to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, and that's why the world hates you. Think about what he's saying there. If we choose to truly belong to the church, then there are going to be consequences in your life. The world is becoming more and more hostile toward the church and the message of Jesus. And I do believe that most of us who truly belong to the church will soon face days where very real persecution becomes a reality. But here's the thing. If we are the church, trying to be the church that Jesus created and has called us to be, even with our flaws and our mistakes, we have an opportunity to have a huge impact on our community and on the world around us. The other thing is we get to do it with other people who are on the same journey that we are as followers of Jesus. We're not alone, and for me, that makes it totally worth it. That's something I want to belong to. Guys, the church isn't perfect now, but together we can prepare for the day that it will be. I want to belong to the body of Christ because one day soon Jesus is returning to complete us and to make us whole. And that means he is coming to complete his church and to make it whole. And together, here at New Hope, with our talents, our passion, our determination, together as a church, we can build his kingdom. We can make this congregation into something special. And I want to be a part of that. To me, it's totally worth it. But you know what? You got to answer that question for yourself today. Is being a part, is belonging to the body, worth it for you? Is what we could accomplish being the church he's called us to be worth it to you? Are you willing to take the steps that are needed for us to accomplish what he's called us to accomplish right here in Montgomery County? Because I got to tell you, it's not just going to be the staff that makes it happen. It's going to be every single one of us saying, I belong to the body, I have a role to play here, and I'm willing to step up and do it. You've got a decision to make. We're going to offer a time of invitation, a song where you can respond. We'll have a couple of our leaders in the back who would love an opportunity to pray with you and talk with you about what it means to become a member here at New Hope, to say, I want to belong to this body, or to come together and say, I want to give my life to Jesus because I want to be a part of the church worldwide, the kingdom. And they would love to start that conversation with you and pray with you about it. Or maybe you just have something going on in your life you need them to pray with you about, and that's fine too. Use the opportunity. This is an invitation for you to respond to what God's putting on your heart right now. Watch this video, and then we're calling on you to respond how you need to today. We believe it's important for you to respond to whatever God may be saying to you. Are you looking for a church home? Have you never made a decision to follow Christ in your life, and today is the day that needs to change? Whatever it is that God is saying to you, respond. Don't leave here the same way you came in. During this next song, take an opportunity. Spend some time in prayer between you and God. You are free to go and talk to one of our staff members in the back, to pray with them, to talk about any decision you may be wrestling with them. Or you can sit and simply talk between you and God, whatever it is that's on your heart. This is our invitation for you to respond however you need to today. Let's sing together. Stand with me as we sing. It's an invitation for you to respond to. We invite you to do that. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down. Heavy stone, Messiah still.
shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Buddy, welcome Trent. Yeah.
Hello.
There we go. So, believe it or not, I'm doing announcements again. So, first things first, September 17th, our church is handling tickets and concessions at the homecoming game at Southmont versus Crawfordsville. So, we're going to need a little help with that. I think his stream broke. Pretty funny. So, October 1st is Faith Night. Our church is attending an Indianapolis Indians game. Tickets are $10 a pop. You can buy those online or on the app. The prayer banner in the back, you can sign up for an hour. This is so that our church is being prayed for every hour of every day of every week. So make sure you fill out a spot on that. Offering, you can give in the black boxes in the back, or you can give on the app. The app, it is free on the App Store. You know, I'm sure you've heard the saying, nothing is free. Well, this is free, believe it or not. It allows you to give offering as well as connect with any groups that you are in and stay up to date on events. So that is it for announcements, if you'd like to join me in prayer. Dear Lord, I'm praying over the families of all of the soldiers that have passed away in Afghanistan, along with all of the innocent civilians. This is such a tragedy. Please be with all of those people. I pray that we leave with a sense of belonging to Christ as well as belonging to this church. Please help us have a safe week. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Trent. Guys, thank you for being here to worship with us today. Let's stand up. We're going to go out of here worshiping and praising God. This song, I love it. There's nothing that our God can't do. And if you believe that, man, proclaim it with your voice today as we go out of here. Let's go out worshiping. Thanks again for being here to worship with us at New Hope.
Just one word.
storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open.
Guys, have an awesome weekend, and next week we'll see you next Sunday.
So alone, you're so afraid, I heard you pray.